Mr. Canar?
Here.
Ms. Ringler?
Here.
Mr. Woods?
Present.
We have eight in a quorum.
Right, it's time for approval of the minutes. Does anybody have any comments on the minutes before we take a vote on that?
Mr. Chairman, I move we approve the minutes.
A second. Chris?
Mr. Armstrong?
Aye.
Ms. Burson?
Aye.
Ms. Cavazos is not here. Mr. Gales?
Aye.
Mr. Haw?
Aye.
Ms. Jordan?
I abstain.
Mr. Canar?
Aye.
Ms. Ringler?
Aye.
Mr. Woods?
Aye.
Motion passes 7-1 abstaining.
All right, the item C, MTPO Policy Board Representative, Mr. Feiner.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This is a housekeeping item that we kind of overlooked a couple months ago when you last met. What normally happens is the Planning Commission Chair serves as the appointee on the MTPO Policy Board, MTPO being Metropolitan Topeka Planning Organization. They are the regional planning, transportation planning body for the area. And so this is, by their bylaws, we have the Planning Commission Chair or their designee serve on that body. I think Commissioner Gales was on that for the last couple of years.
2 years.
So thank you for your service. When Mr. Canar became our chair, it's up to him now whether he would want to serve or not. There has been some interest by Mr. Armstrong to serve on that board. So for fairness, we just want to make sure if there's any interest to serve on that board, to let me know. And then I will meet with the chair so he can designate representative. So I think we've been... we've missed last month, so that's just, we didn't have a chance to handle that. We usually do that January, February, so getting a late start on that. But nonetheless, if you have any interest, any questions, again, let me know. They are deal with transportation planning issues, and we meet once a month, going through a pretty big exercise right now, as a matter of fact. So that's, and hopefully, and please let me know. See, the meeting is, next meeting's Thursday, so if you could let me know as soon as possible, by tomorrow at the latest, we can get this wrapped up. Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you. Are there any communications to the commission?
Yes, I have a couple. speaking of transportation planning, I mentioned a big exercise going on right now, just to kind of save the date, if you will. We'll have our Futures 2040 meeting, which is our large 25-year transportation plan. We have our final public meeting on May 3rd at the library at 5:30. We would love to see if any of you wanted to attend. We sometimes what we brief you here as a group, but I think this would be a very a good educational thing for any of the commissioners to be aware of in terms of our transportation planning. So May 3rd, 5:30 at the library. Also another save the date, a little more fun. Not that that's not fun, but a little more fun on the transportation side. We have our bike with the mayor it'll be bike with the mayor and city manager, interim city manager. That's gonna be on May 17th. More details to follow. We would love to see you out supporting our efforts to make Topeka a multimodal community. We had great participation last year, and I heard there might be a two-seater bike out there some people might be riding. Tomorrow City Council will be taking up the zoning code updates and the downtown zoning updates that you passed back in February. So just a FYI, I have received several questions. We have responded. I not to look ahead too much, but I think we have addressed all those. So that will be on tomorrow night for action. And then last but not least, there was a rumor we might have to change Commissioner Burson's nameplate next month. I just may have heard that. She looks pretty calm right now, so just want to wish you best of luck in advance and congratulations. We will take care of your nameplate whenever you let us know if that's the case. If not,
it's going to happen. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Finder.
Yeah, you're welcome. That's all my
Mr. Chairman, may I ask what will it be?
It'll be Mrs. Messina.
Messina, okay.
Messina. Yep.
Right. Awesome.
All right. This time, does anybody, any commission member have a declaration of conflict of interest or ex parte communications to declare? Mr. Armstrong?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I will be stepping out for item F1 this evening.
Anybody else? All right, we are ready to move on to item F, the public hearings. CU-043B Forest Park, presentation at this time by Ms. Driver.
This is case CU-043B. The applicant is Forest Park Conference Retreat Center. Property is at 3158 Southeast 10th Avenue. They're requesting to amend their conditional use permit that allowed for a conference retreat center that because they are expanding their boundary and including a 5-acre property located to their immediate east, which is on the north side of Southeast 10th Avenue. It's currently zoned R1 single family dwelling district. The initial CUP originally contained 35 acres at the northeast intersection of Southeast 10th Avenue and Deer Creek Parkway. They're adding in a 5-acre tract just to the immediate east, which is vacant. The CUP that was approved back in 2004 allowed for private conferences and retreats associated with the retreat center, the Forest Park retreat center. The amendment to the CUP allows the use of an undeveloped 5-acre wooded property for the use of low-intensity outside activities. Some of those would be haunted trails and prayer walks. Other similar activities of equal or lesser intensity, as determined by the planning director. Just going into a little background behind this, the history of this property. In 1920, it was established by the United Methodist Church as a conference center. In 1950, it was annexed into the city and zoned for single family purposes. In 1958, it was rezoned to multiple family. In 2004, it was rezoned to single family again, and the CUP was approved to allow them to use it as a conference center for privately arranged events that were in conjunction with the purposes of their church. Then in 2015, a minor amendment was approved to allow some limited activities that were open to the public up to a maximum of 60 cumulative days per year. Prior to this, all the events were privately arranged and associated with the Methodist Church. They have parking on site for up to 271 spaces. Those were provided in 2004. Those were approved in 2004. An occupancy limit was put on any single event up to 300 people. The parking was approved on gravel and overflow grass parking surfaces. At that time, staff city did not require they pave any parking. The intent was to preserve the rustic character of the site. For that reason, staff conditioned the parking limit to a maximum occupancy of 300 people. This revision to the CUP didn't make any changes to that requirement because they were not making changes to their CUP that increase the intensity of their use or change the occupancy limit for public event, for any events open to the public. A note has been added to the CUP that addressed the legal nonconforming nature of the existing parking and timing of when future improvements might be needed if they're to add new buildings in the future. Once again, the change only adds property into the CUP for some outside activities. They're not adding additional buildings. The applicant conducted a neighborhood meeting on February 23rd. No opposition was expressed at that meeting relative to this proposal. The area is designated commercial. It's within the East Topeka Neighborhood Revitalization Plan. The plan, however, specifically limits commercial activities to conference, retreat, recreational ventures that preserve the natural setting of the area. So this is in conformance to that designation in the plan. The 5-acre property that is being added in is likely not suitable for single family anymore, as it's been vacant since at least 1942, as shown from our aerial maps. The intent of the CUP is to allow low-intensity outdoor activities on the site. Forest Park has existed on the site for 35 years since it, on the 35-acre site since at least 1920. There's no development proposed that affects the intensity of the CUP. Furthermore, the number and intensity of events is limited by the CUP. There have not been any issues arising from past events on their site. Staff is recommending approval subject to the conditions in the staff report, and I'm open for questions they may have.
All right, does anybody have any questions for Ms. Driver? Seeing none, and if a representative of the applicant is present, I'd like to hear from you.
Good evening, Commissioners. Angela Sharp with Bartlett and West, representing Forest Park. I also have with me Jeanette Johnson, who is on the board of directors for Forest Park, and we're here to answer any questions you might have, or we would hope for your approval so that we can, a recommendation of approval, so we can move on to the next steps.
All right, thank you, Ms. Sharp. Do any of the commissioners have any questions for Ms. Sharp? Yes, Mr. Gales.
Mr. Chairman, I just verifying that there were the four items that the staff has included as part of their recommendations. Your clients reviewed all those and is accepting of all those? Okay. Thank you.
Does anybody else have a question for Ms. Sharp? All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Are there any members of the public present that would like to address the commission? All right. Seeing nobody, it's time we will close the public hearing. And any discussion among the commissioners, if anybody have anything they would like to discuss on the item? Hearing nothing, do we have them up? Mr. Gales?
Yeah, I just want to kind of briefly, if I may, ask staff. Mm-hmm. So if I understand correctly, they still have some flexibility to add built structures subject to accommodations for parking and other things, but it's somewhat limited because of the parking limitations, if I interpret how you've represented it.
That's correct. They are limited by an occupancy limit up to 300 for any one event they have at the same time.
And they have parking for 271. So to really improve the property at this point forward, they'd have to offset that by doing something else, or the improvement would occur within an existing structure.
Right.
Okay.
Does anybody have any further comment or question? I would entertain a motion.
I want to make a brief comment. I think, you know, in long term, this is an industrial environment, but this is probably sound land banking policies. I mean, this could go on indefinitely as long as it didn't restrict other kind of expansion or growth in the area that, you know, wasn't agreeable to, you know, the property owners participating in. But, you know, I think this is pretty sound, kind of keeping the status quo with improvements, but not doing it in a detrimental way to a higher use that it sits in. So with that being said, I move for approving the motion as described with the stipulations by staff.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any conversation, any comment on that? I would voice my support for it, noting that the additional 5 acres has been vacant for some 7 years. Seems appropriate, and we hear absolutely no objection. So, hearing no further comment, Chris, would you please take the roll?
Ms. Burson?
Aye.
Mr. Gales?
Aye.
Mr. Hall?
Aye.
Ms. Jordan?
Aye.
Mr. Kinnear?
Aye.
Ms. Ringler?
Aye.
Mr. Woods?
Aye.
Motion passes 7-0 with one abstaining.
All right, and if we could get Mr. Armstrong back. Prepared to proceed with the public hearing on public hearing two, resource developments, A1702, requesting annex into the city, property located at 3636 Southeast Warner, or 6th. Mr. Warner, would you please go ahead with that?
You bet. Commissioners, this property is approximately 12 acres. The additional land is being requested for annexation. It's related to the previously approved food manufacturing and distribution use that is adjacent to the property to the east. The property is contiguous to the existing city boundary. Unilateral annexations of this type, one where the owner has consented to annexation and the property is contiguous, require City of Topeka governing body approval. Planning Commission review and of annexations is not required specifically by state statute. However, our land use and growth management plan established a policy that the Planning Commission should review annexations greater than 10 acres for consideration and recommendation based on land use growth management principles of the comprehensive plan. So we'll get into that a little bit. The Topeka Land Use and Growth Management Plan encourages quality urban growth by promoting policies of a prosperous community. Policies related to this annexation state that new growth should lead to a return on investment, which means Topeka's infrastructure and service investments are down payments to the future. It is imperative to develop those areas with existing investments at a level that seeks the greatest return on those investments.
Whoops.
The subject property and the area around it are located within the Topeka urban growth area. Which means there is an expectation that this area will urbanize in the future. The community has made significant investments in infrastructure and services to support urbanization. City of Topeka water and sewer is available. The city has also constructed a fire station to serve the area. Major transportation investments have been made, which include improvements to Southeast 6th Street, to a 5-lane section, and also the construction of the Oakland Expressway. The subject property lies within Tier 3 of the urban growth area, and generally speaking, Tier 3 areas are not ready for urbanization because investments haven't been made in all 5 of Topeka's urban services, which are fire, police, water, sewer, and streets. But as I just mentioned, those services and investments have been made in this area. So annexing and developing the property generates significant return on those previous investments in infrastructure and services and allows the city to grow in a compact and cost-effective manner. So staff recommends that the proposed annexation is based on land use and growth management principles of the comprehensive plan, and specifically the motion for this item is on the screen above. I'll read it here real quick. So to make a motion to, you know, should say upon consideration of the proposed annexation request, it is the commission's determination that the annexation is or is not consistent with the land use and growth management plan. So with that, commissioners, I'll be happy to. Right, and as I stated earlier, we do recommend that it is consistent with the comprehensive plan. Questions?
Commissioners, does anybody have any questions for Mr. Warner?
Mr. Chairman, I have one. Maybe you stated, but I didn't quite catch it in your first comments. Did we have clarity as to the reason behind the fairly quick transition from us just approving this to annexing additional land, or acquiring additional land and requesting the annex? Was there clarity given in what their demand for the extra space is for?
I think there are site considerations. The site is the site that was previously approved and annexed isn't quite big enough for everything that they want to do, as far as fitting everything and having truck circulation and whatnot. So they were in the process of buying this property through that process, but didn't get it acquired in time. So once that came on board, you know, this just allows a little more flexibility in developing the site and making sure trucks can get around and whatnot.
Okay.
Commissioners, any further questions?
Mr. Chair, we do have, I believe, a representative. If you would like to better answer that question for Mr. Gills than we can, Mr. Morse might be.
I think we can continue proceeding with questions for Mr. Warner at the moment, and I'm sure their representative will be happy to address that as part of their presentation.
Mr. Chairman, I'm fine with Mr. Warner's response for now, and I think we'll allow the owner's representative to elaborate further if they'd like.
Thank you, Mr. Gales. Does anybody have any further questions? All right, then we are ready for the research representative to come up.
Good evening. I am Mike Morse. I'm with Kansas Commercial Real Estate, and I'm the reason that we're here today. I apologize, because if my company was able to secure this property in a different timing, we would have had it all packaged the first time around. But it also allowed us to react differently. We have our engineering division here, and you'll see this when we show the site plan. After our first meeting with the public, we had points of contention or things to change. They said, yeah, it'd be better if you could move this or you could move that. By adding this site, we're able to address those concerns from the public. We were able to move the wastewater treatment facility farther away from Croco. We're able to move it farther away and farther back away from 6th Street. Those are things that are much better, so they can't see it. So it's a better, everything is moving farther away from residents is what we're doing by being able to add this site. So it's gonna be a friendlier site, it's gonna be better to the neighborhood. It will allow for better traffic flow, but I mean, the best thing about this is it's better for everybody. It makes the plant operate better, but it's also much better for the neighborhood because it will take some of the things you don't want to see out of sight. It also, yes, we were working on the site the entire time, but we could not, the person who we were working with, they had unfortunately passed away. And they, so things happen. So it wasn't anything to do to slow, to be not straightforward with you, but it was just things happen and we're now here.
Do you have a further comment on
we have
what we've got going here?
What else do we have? Do we have what other pictures do we have? For this annexation, that's it.
This is just the annexation, so just attempting to explain the reasons behind the annexation.
Why didn't have it all together once.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just more of a comment, I guess, than a question. Like Mr. Gales, I was a little surprised to have this show up this quickly, and this is perhaps my securities regulation background coming in. That's not a buyer beware world. Future purposes. I would prefer to, I don't recall there being any discussion at that time. That additional property was under consideration, and I think that might have, I don't think it would have changed my vote in any way, shape, or form,
sure.
But it would have been more complete and looks better that it would have been disclosed earlier. And if it couldn't have been, it couldn't have been.
Obviously, negotiations were, we were having, we wanted the land, we needed the land, but we were having difficulty communicating with that person. We reached out to their heirs and attorneys, and it just was a process. Then we had to get through the estate and settlement, and so, you know, just the process of what it takes to get there. So to always be forthright, that without a doubt, I'd much rather do it once than twice. We don't want our guys to have to fly from Oregon to do this every, you know, every time. Not that they don't like flying in for your meeting, but we are also, you know, be always upfront. If research has the opportunity to grow, we're going to look at land to grow. And then we want to, you know, to always be forthright. If there's a logical way to grow, hopefully we're back again, because we want research to grow here. So yes, and it'd always be, you know, to communicate. If we have an opportunity to go again and talk about putting a plant here, well, I hope we're back in front of you. I hope we are.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Morse. Do any commissioners have any other questions related to the annexation?
I have a question.
Yes, Mr. Strong.
Do you foresee this particular site being at its maximum size, or are you thinking in terms of...
For this plant, this meets our needs for this plant. But that, you know, that said, as we always be up front, we've had neighbors reach out to us. You know, after we've... You know, there's a plant going in next door. We've had people reach out to us to talk about if we'd recently be willing to purchase their property. To say that, you know, like I said, we'll talk. And we want to be good neighbors. If somebody wants to come in and discuss a fair value to try to acquire property, research wants to treat people like they want to be treated. And if there's opportunity to do so, we'll talk. So, yeah, does it get necessary? No. Is it fair to say that we won't at some point have a different opportunity come before us, and we have had opportunities? Yeah, we might be back, but it's not that we don't need it. I mean, the plant's going, footings are in. I mean, the site's good. There's things we operational in 5 months. It's going, but it's just we might be back with different sets of land because people are approaching us.
Okay. Any further questions at this time? All right, thank you very much,
Mr.
Morse. Do we have any members of the public that would like to address us at this time? Seeing no one, then we'll close the public hearing. Commissioners, do we have any further questions for staff?
Mr. Chairman, I have a question,
yes,
if I may, please. And this might be a procedural question. I realize, if I may ask of Ms. Feeney, and maybe staff can answer, but so since there are two parts to this one, the second part is actually dealing with the changes to the master plan as it was previously approved. When we review for approval or non-approval the annexation, are we to be careful that we don't, can things, you know, since this next element is something that we're reviewing, can we ask questions about what are part of the master plan in our consideration of the annexation, or should we wait for that component of it at this time?
Well, the next item is the zoning item.
I understand.
Whether to zone contingent upon the annexation being approved by the
correct
body.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I mean,
well,
you're not talking about amending the master plan.
No, I'm sorry, let me see here. Requesting a major amendment to the master plan unit development I-1 light industrial. So it is an amendment. The next step, item B, that we'll take up after we approve A. I'm reading the language in our the description of the
right.
Items we have before us. So it is an amendment to
amendment
the master
to
plan.
To the PUD, correct.
To the PUD, yes, the master plan.
Right, and at that point, there'll be a public hearing.
I understand. So what I'm trying to get, maybe I'm not making clear the reasoning behind my question, is we've been asked to approve the annexation. And as a board, I want to make sure that we're asking all the questions we need to ask so that we show due diligence in whatever decision we make, because we have been, we have received commentary from the elected body that we many times don't ask enough questions or get enough clarity on items. So I just want to make sure if we're asking questions and getting clarity that we know, because there are, these are in order. And can we ask questions about those things that'll be on before us within the PUD? Because to me, that's part of the reasoning behind whether or not we approve the annexation or not.
We're not approving the annexation. We're just approving, making a decision that the request is consistent with the land use management. You're not approving the annexation.
Okay.
Your scope of review is very narrow. You just
understood.
Have to look at the request and say, is it consistent with the land use and growth management plan? Yeah, you don't get into particulars about.
That's what I needed to hear.
That belongs to the governing body.
So, that is whether or not to approve the annexation. But in our review of whether or not it meets the guidelines, do we take into consideration those things, the requested uses of the land as it may be presented before us? And this, okay, that's all I needed to know. Thank you. Thank you for my long-winded, winding question, Mr. Chairman. So,
if it's any of any comfort, I went through the same mental gymnastics earlier today on this.
Fair enough.
So I understand, and I think the governing body, I hope, will understand based on your question and my indication this time that, maybe they're, obviously annexation is somewhat contingent on approval of the PUD. It doesn't seem to make sense. From their point, we're not approving anything.
Right. And to that point, if I may elaborate, I think it's important that we make sure we are asking whatever questions we deem necessary to get clarity so that when it does go before the elected body, that we have at least done our obligation of due diligence and not just heard it and approved it. Because we have been, we've received commentary in the past that they need additional information. Mm-hmm. So I'm just trying to make sure, even if we're not sure, that we're getting clarity so that we do know where we can get the clarity that we need. So I appreciate staff and your patience as I work my way through that.
Thank you. Do other people have comments or discussion they'd want to enter into before we entertain a motion on the matter? I would note that the conditions for this property are significantly the same as the conditions on the adjacent property that we already reviewed, approved, sent on to the city council for their approval. And it would seem to me inconsistent to approve the last one and then to turn around today and not need this to be consistent. That being said, everybody, gets to do it their own way. But obviously, I voted for it last time, and I believe this will to be the same. There. Mr. Gales?
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, I would move that upon consideration of the proposed annexation request, we make the motion is that the commission's determination that the annexation is consistent with the land use and growth management plan and that we approve it.
I would second that motion.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any comment or discussion? Hearing none, I'd like to take a vote on the motion as put forward by Mr. Gales. Chris?
Mr. Woods?
Aye.
Ms. Ringler?
Aye.
Mr. Kinnear?
Aye.
Ms. Jordan?
Aye.
Mr. Hall?
Aye.
Mr. Gales?
Aye.
Ms. Burson?
Aye.
Mr. Armstrong?
Aye.
Motion passes 8-0.
Okay. Thank you. Moving on, we are ready to take up the PUD 1605, presentation by Ms. Driver.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is PUD 165A. It is an amendment to the Master Plan Unit Development Plan for Reeser's Fine Foods, which is I-1 uses. It includes property to the west at 36, it's just property to the west at 3636 Southeast 6th Avenue, and then the property to the north at 349 Southeast Croker Road. And they're highlighted in red on the map that's up on the screen before you. The purpose of the major amendment to the PUD plan is really to relocate the wastewater pretreatment building and the stormwater detention facility on the property to the property at 3636 Southeast 6th Street. The intent of this in relocating the building allows for better truck circulation and a wider driveway behind the back of the building. And it also places the buildings low on the property, making them less visible from 6th Street. The property to the north will remain undeveloped. There are two existing single-family residences on both of these properties. They'll continue to be used for single-family for the limit of the leases that are run for 1 to 5 years. After that time, the PUD plan does designate both of those properties for no additional development except what's shown on the plan. The applicant held another neighborhood information meeting on Monday, March 27th. Five people attended that meeting, and none of them had any negative comments at the meeting that night. As discussed with back in December, the PUD master plan does contain requirements, design elements that address building setbacks, landscape berming along the streets, as well as architectural components. Those were done to help preserve the area's residential character. This amendment to the PUD doesn't alter or change any of those conditions. It's primarily just relocates the wastewater building, making it lower down on the site, less visible from 6th Street. Also adds some open space and buffers around the building. We place a larger distance between the building and surrounding residential properties. A landscape plan has also been altered to add some landscaping along the frontage of 6th, further west, where they're adding in the property. The properties at 349 Croco and 3636 6th Street are likely still suitable for single family, as that's their current use. And they're currently going to be used for single family still in the short term. However, adding those into the PUD provides additional open space. It also incorporates a stream buffer into the design. And it creates a better transition between the industrial development and residential uses surrounding it. Additionally, the wider driveway that's behind the building encourages truck traffic to use 6th Street rather than having trucks use Croco, where there's more residential properties. Having the stream buffer on the site also has allowed Shawnee County to allowed Reeser's to dedicate a trail easement that will allow Shawnee County to construct a trail connection in the future, which would be adjacent with the stream buffer. Staff does recommend approval, and I am open for any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Driver. Any commissioner have questions for Ms. Driver?
Mr. Chairman, I have a question. Ms. Driver, did they clarify for you what the change in building height might be with the relocation of the waste treatment building further to the west?
The change in what?
Building height,
building
elevation,
height.
The elevation.
The height of the wastewater building is...
How about the change in its topographic placement?
No, I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know
ask,
exactly. But
I can save my question for
their representative. Their applicant is here to address mm-hmm. that. The elevations are attached as well.
Thank you, Mr. Gales. Other commissioners have questions from Ms. Driver? No one? Then please be time for us to have the applicant approach.
Good evening, counselors. It's nice to be back here again. Would have rather done it the first time, but as we said, it wasn't available. So the guys back at the office we've redone it a couple times. So anyway, I guess it keeps us busy. You asked about the height. Are you talking about, it's about 6 feet lower than the truck dock, so it would be about 10 feet lower than the building finished floor of the building itself. Are you talking about the wall height?
Mr. Chairman, may I ask? Could you clarify the change in elevation from the previous placement to the new placement?
It's about 3 to 4 feet lower on the thing. Plus, it's tucked in. There's some larger trees along 6th Street that are now assist instead of a straight look down the driveway to it. So, and we also are moving the pond stormwater facility back closer to the creek in order to allow any further expansion in the maneuvering area instead of having it right there, right in the middle of it. So that was the two major changes that we're doing, along with adding the easement for the trail. And the property to the north was annexed previously, but was not part of the PUD, so it was just a timing thing. So that's all it is. But any other questions?
Mr. Chair,
yes.
Can we, for the record, it would help Chris if he states his name. And,
Yes. Sorry. Greg Harris, AAI Engineering.
Thanks, Greg.
So.
Sorry about that, Mr. Finder. Should have brought that to attention.
As far as the parking lot stayed the same up front, the driveways have all stayed the same. Everything else has stayed the same. We just basically added some more truck maneuvering area along the west property, moved the treatment plant back further out of the way, and the pond also for anything further.
Ms. Driver indicated that this was going to allow more traffic ingress and egress on 6th Street as opposed to Croca. Do we know how much traffic how much percentage-wise that's changing?
I don't know about percentage-wise. The research, all the other facilities are down 6th. So there's most of the traffic will be coming in and out of the 6th Street driveway for trucks. It always was. It always will be. This just allows, if a truck is backed into the dock, there's an additional 20, 30 feet there now for maneuverability. Opens it up, allows trucks to be able to back in and get around a little bit easier. So I always thought that, I mean, traffic-wise, we kind of have to say it's some here, some there. But in reality, they're going back and forth to the DC plant, the distribution center that's down on 6th. And so that'll be almost all the traffic. So.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question. Just for clarity, was the stream buffer zone already in place when the replat process started, or?
That is correct. Okay. That was a known factor that we had that we worked with and made sure that we were staying out of that, and also added the trail.
So there were no modifications required based on any of that?
No, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Armstrong.
So the stormwater detention pond moved northwest from its previous location?
That's correct. Previously, we didn't have the property to the west, so we were discharging along our west property line and letting it sheet flow across to the creek. Now we're actually closer to the creek, so the creek's actually on our property, so now we can still sheet flow across into the creek, but it's right next to it instead of across the neighboring property.
So how's the stormwater getting from the site to the detention pond?
It'll all be graded to catch basins, collected via pipes, and then piped to that pond. And actually, one of the other comments that was concerned last time you might remember was the stormwater on the street. We've worked with the city and engineers, and we're taking all the water up to the north property line for the expansion and running it along the north property line to the creek directly, So we will be removing all that excess water that was previously going down the ditches. So we should actually help the neighbors quite a bit with this. So I think it'll be a big benefit to everybody downstream of that. So.
Were there berms necessary with the previous version, and are those still in place?
There was berms along the 6th Street and Crow Cove frontage where we were above elevation of the road, and those are still there and still maintained, still heavy landscaped. So, and we have no development going on the north property at this time. So right now the berms would be wrapping around the previous, if you zoom in, you can kind of see the berm wraps around that property line to maintain where those two residents are. So it's that's staying the same, so.
Mr. Chairman, just if I may ask a clarification question, if I want to make sure I interpreted what you said correctly. Whereas before, the surface water on the paving basically sheet drained off of the paving down across the existing grade and towards the creek, it will now be curbed and collected through the two catch basins and routed up to, before you didn't have the detention pond, now you do. And I'm just trying to make sure I understand.
No, we had the detention pond. It was always there. We haven't changed it for that. We only moved the location of the pond to the north, or to the west, excuse me. And a little bit there's, so it was always curbed. It was always collected on site, the roof, downspouts, everything's hard pipe to that pond, so it won't be sheet flowed.
I was going to say, I thought I remembered that being in that northwest corner before, and it's just moving as per your drawing. So correct. I misinterpreted what you said.
Yes, basically where the arrow pointing to it, where the arrow starts, is where the pond was before, and we're just able to move it further west to get it out. If we would have left it there, chances are we'd need truck or some type of a maneuvering area, and then the pond would have been there, and it would have been expensive in the future. So we can't really go any further west. There's a creek there and the buffer, so we moved it as far as we could. Plus, it's the low end of the site, so that made the most sense. So.
Excellent. Thank you.
Any other questions, Commissioners? Seeing none, thank you very much, Mr. Harris,
for the
time. Do we have members of the public present that would like to comment at this time? When you do come forward, please state your name so Chris can take it down and direct any comments that you have to the chair.
My name is Janice Spiker. I live at 526 Southeast Croco Road. And thank you for letting me speak tonight. I have two thank yous, one to Kevin Holland and one to Ms. Driver for removing the porta pots from in front of our driveway. That was very much appreciated. Thank you. We're going to have to hurry along here. Do we know if there's going to be a fence at 6th and Croco Corner north in front of the research property, and how many driveways, entrances, are there going to be from Croco into research? I have that question. And what will the shift change hours be? That's a question. And the bus stop. Where exactly is the bus stop going to be? Is it going to be in front of the driveway of the quick shop store that's already there? Is it going to be in front of our driveway? Is there any consideration at all moving it to the opposite corner to 6th Street? That's another one of my questions. The other one, industrial parks. Why aren't our industrial parks being used for something like this instead of taking in a residential area? It's already happened. But are the industrial parks being introduced to these big companies that want to take over residential areas? Now we put up, we have a lot of machinery noise. We're not complaining. We have a lot of dirt. We wash our car about every 3 days. And they've done a good job keeping the dirt down. The rain has helped. But those are my concerns, and I would like to maybe hear some answers on those questions if I can, some research tonight. And I know I only have 2 minutes.
I understand. I appreciate that. And I would personally like to thank you for thanking staff and members.
Yeah.
I don't think they hear that enough from the public. We usually just get
and
the
And I should have said that it happened in a day and a half. That was a record. But it was very nice to have them removed. Thank you.
Thank
Mr.
you.
Mr. Chairman, if I may ask
yes,
a question of the lady. Just for clarity, ma'am, maybe I'm missing, did you have a chance to attend the neighborhood meeting where they would have been able to maybe get your questions for you answered?
I was not able to attend the March 27th meeting.
Okay.
This is unrelated, but I'm on chemo, so that was my chemo day.
I can appreciate that.
I was not able to go that day.
No issues here. And to that point, since the plan was previously presented to us, and while, as stated by the engineer, the only real changes they're requesting to their prescribed improvements are on that part that's on the westernmost side away from there. As I look at the site plan, nearly everything else on the immediate plant site is almost identical to the previously presented project that we had before us when some of these questions were asked of us, and while I'm all for them repeating them, I just wanted to make sure that may have not have been a planning commission meeting you were able to attend either.
Yeah.
Then,
well, at this time, I see possibly three entrances.
Yes, ma'am.
And so I guess there's two homeowners, actually three houses there. That we're wondering if the entrance and the exits are going to be right across from our driveways or not.
Okay.
Because I've been a shift worker. I know how shift workers drive.
Sure, absolutely. they're either in a hurry to get there or they're in a hurry to get home. So
and I've been a shift change accident. I know.
And I guess what I want to emphasize is while I greatly appreciate your questioning, they're not requesting any changes to what we previously proposed there. But however, I would have no issues with them addressing your concerns. I just wanted to make sure that you were aware that when this site design that we're seeing is about 98% identical to what we saw and approved already. The questions that are before us today deal with the modifications along the properties that were annexed now to the west and the north. And while I have no issues if they would like to address, I would, my concern is I think that those concerns, they did a good job of addressing them before, but I would give them deference to answer your question if we need to bring them back up. So
well, I've asked you questions before and they haven't been answered. So.
Fair enough.
If these Collins.
Okay. I think what we'll do is we'll defer to the chairman if he would like to have him, you know. But I just wanted to make sure in my questions to you that I understood the statement. So I appreciate you being able to seek your answers. So thank you, Mr. Chairman.
No, thank you, Mr. Gales. I think what I'm going to do, I'm going to let anybody from the public make their comments and questions that they want to make, and then allow the applicant to come up and make response to all of them at the same time, right, in the interest to the extent that they choose to answer that, and to the extent that they don't choose to answer that, perhaps the commissioners themselves will take that up.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Do we have any other members of the public that wish to speak? Seeing no one else, if Representative Farisers would like to come up and address the questions that were just made.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Kevin Holland, Cook Flat and Strobel Engineers, and I'll try to get, I believe there were three questions, if I'm not mistaken, and the first one is there's three entrances off of Croco, and I believe they are unchanged from previously, and that's why I think some of the site improvements have been done to the west, so that we'd always anticipated or hoped that the truck traffic would stay on that west 6 entrance, and if you make it even more convenient and easier to maneuver their big trucks on that west side, they stay on that entrance versus going through a residential area, which is a little more difficult for them to maneuver. So with that, the three, Reesers has 9 shift chains. They don't have a hard shift change. They stagger their shift changes. So between 5 a.m. and 1 a.m., they have 9 separate shift changes, which would accommodate 40 to 50 people at each of those shift changes. So I can try to answer you that a little more. We can have a research representative answer that a little more specifically, but roughly 9 shift changes across those 20 hours. And then the bus stop is, and I might defer to city staff on that, that's a little more difficult. And we work closely with TMTA as well and working with them to try to figure out a good location of a bus stop. And at this point, they don't have a bus route towards this location. And to her point of putting the bus stop across the street, Topeka Transit is not a big fan of putting people on the other side of the development and having them walk across a 5-lane arterial road. And so that's been the communication from them, and I believe the city as well, that they don't want to dump the people off on the south side of 6, have them go across the busy street, even if it is at a signal. So they're trying to work with Reesers to put a bus stop that makes sense. We are trying to make one to be able to have the buses go within Reesers' route, which was very difficult of how they were going to transition that. But that is an ongoing topic, and I believe once TMTA has a route in this location, they'll work with Reesers to make something happen. But that's why that site across from 6th Street was eliminated, and not to mention getting the bus back towards the city on 6th Street as well.
We can, if you'd like, I think staff can add to that answer on the bus stop at least.
I think the recent discussions between, and it's kind of all dependent on research working with TMTA, but TMTA's latest discussions is that they would like to place it on the north side of 6, but it all depends kind of on the route and if Reesers is agreeable to where they place it. But they're working at doing it on the north side of 6 at this point.
That's true.
At some location. It's not shown on the PUD plan because the location itself might change. However, there is a note that indicates they're willing to provide a pad for a bus stop, subject to approval by the Topeka Metropolitan Transit Authority and the city traffic engineer. So there's a note that addresses they're agreeable to providing a pad for a bus stop and what else is needed to accommodate a bus stop. But the location itself is not on there because it's the route is still in discussion.
Right.
But recent, the TMTA is considering a route that would allow them to stop on the north side of 6th now.
Thank you, Mr. Driver.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Gales.
Mr. Holland, if I may, I don't want to re-debate the placement of drives, but for clarity, since the question was asked, could you kind of, first I would note that the only street that enters the neighborhood to the east of this is St. Jane Way, that is in direct proximity to any of the approaches onto the property in question. That appears to be about 250 feet north of the northernmost entrance, which appears to be more of the bigger vehicle access, or it looks like it also employee access too. Pertaining to the other two drives that are more down towards where there's some homes, I know that you don't technically allow driveways to control where you put approaches or entrances unless, you know, there's larger counts of vehicles on both sides. But from a best practices, what is kind of the philosophy behind how you place those when you know you have, say, residences across the street?
So, and that's a difficult question. In this one, and I can defer to Craig a little bit as well, but what it is, we're dealing with a sunken site at the southeast corner, mm-hmm. and so grade kind of dictated that first entrance location. as well as his city traffic would want it as far away from Croco as possible, so that you don't have that entrance closed off by stacking or anything else. But so as we got back down to grade, there was an entrance, and that allowed the parking down to the south, that large lot there. I believe public or employee parking could also come off of the sixth entrance, but if it's a truck access, most of the time you're probably going to go where trucks are not. And so assuming most of your workers are probably going to try to come in off of the Croco entrances. So okay. If you're going to park on the south side of that, and it's hard to say, most people,
human nature,
typical, they're going to park as close to the building as possible. And earlier shifts are going to park closer, and the further shifts are going to park out further. But it's one of those, I would assume, as you're driving in, you'll be able to see how it fills up, and you'll go either south or north.
Understood.
But that the secondary entrance there to the north was put forward when we originally came in. I think we had two entrances off the east, and we discussed with staff that three might be a better situation, so that we don't have an issue with one primary entrance going north and south there. Now there's a secondary release route on that northern entrance.
Okay.
But
Thank you.
I know I kind of skirted that question a little bit, but it as you put it, depending on how many cars are coming out, and you try to put them lining up with an entrance across the street so that you're not creating cross conflict from the entries and exits.
Understood. Thank you.
Does anyone else have a question for Mr. Holland right now?
Mr. Chair, there was a question about a fence.
Okay. I was coming to that next if
okay,
nobody else
sorry.
Did. No problem.
And I do not believe there is a fence to the north. If I believe they have a berm, landscaping berm to the north, and then there's the property as it sits today. But I don't believe as a part of this project there's a fence being...
Mr. Chairman, the
yes,
drawing
Mr.
represents a 5-foot tall berm. That'd be mm-hmm. the land height, not the landscaping on top of it. Is that your understanding? It's still
that
5 foot?
Correct.
Okay. Which I would say is pretty close to your standard commercial fence in a similar circumstance. So okay.
That was how I read it, but I wanted to hear it from somebody who drew it.
Sure. I did have one last question.
Yes, Mr. Gaff.
Mr. King. And this may be in your wheelhouse, if not, if it's the other gentleman's. Was there a substantial change in surface area of paving from the previous plan to this one, the previously approved plan to this one? Was there?
And I'm going to have to defer to Craig on
okay.
that, because I believe he did the drainage report.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
Does anybody have any further questions for Mr. Holland before we finish that up? No one? All right, move along.
So the only added surface area would be basically the around the treatment plant.
Okay.
And the curb was about 5 feet off of that western property line, and now it extends over. So it's
off
a little bit more, but that's
off the top
it.
Of your head, could you give me a reasonable percentage of increase?
10%.
Okay.
Pretty minor.
All right.
And the pond was increased, and we calculated
account.
Based on that. So
okay.
And again, back to the driveways, we didn't move anything. Basically, from the western building line, or to the east of that. So
to that point, what you're saying is the main building itself did not move any. It was simply
the building did not move.
It was the circulation for the larger vehicles to the west that were
yeah,
that was improved.
The western building line to the west is all that we adjusted. We had nothing
okay.
east of that back part has changed at all. So we actually did add a little bit more landscaping, so that was about it. So.
Okay. Thank you.
Does anybody have any additional questions? All right, thank you very much. Before I close the public hearing, does anybody have a reason why we shouldn't close it at this time? And make sure there's no other member of the public that wants to come forward. All right. No objections, then we're going to go ahead and close the public hearing and discuss the matter. Does anybody have comments they'd like to make before we get into making formal motions here? As Mr. Gales noted earlier, we've had the comment that we don't discuss our decisions quite enough. So I'll throw it out to start with it. You know, it seems to me the decision we've got in front of us right now is whether or not to send on to the city council to allow the system or the situation to go forward as we last approved it, or to look at this and decide whether or not this doesn't amount to an improvement over what was already in existence. Given the lack of public uproar and finding fault with the changes, which I'm sure if they had found them, given what we saw at the last meeting, they would have been here because they care about the area. It appears to me that this presents an improvement, in particular in changing the sight line on the runoff and reducing the flow of water that people raise concerns about going down Croco Road. It works better for Reesers in terms of their truck operation. And I don't see a reason, and haven't heard a reason yet, not to support it. Do other people have comments, discussion? Yes, Mr. Armstrong.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I do agree. I think hydraulically that this stormwater plan is an upgrade from the original, pushing the detention pond closer to the stream, not letting it outlet and just sheet flow over to the stream. I think it is a better layout and would work better for that. And the addition of the trail easement to add some future walkability along the west side, I think, would be another added bonus to this over the previous version.
Thank you, Mr. Armstrong. Further discussion?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to add a few comments. I know we spoke at length about why we approved this the first time. And I think everything we've seen about their approach is kind of the right attitude to have about forward-thinking projects like this, where we're trying to be less frequently going concentrically further away from our cities as we build places where we work. And while we have kind of this challenge where our county or our city property line kind of weaves in and out and we're surrounded by residential, it's actually not a bad thing to build more work opportunities internally where there is space for that and the utilities are already there and access is already there. So we're minimizing a lot of our infrastructure expansion. And we're and I know that it's always a challenge when people live in a certain area and then they see something go up next door that's counter to what they thought would always be there. But everything I've seen from them so far is that they've had a very forward-thinking attitude about that, and I concur with Mr. Armstrong that even their improvements, I think, are improvements above and beyond what they did before. Yes, they acquired additional property, and if anything, it added an extra green space to their site, and they didn't necessarily just go out there and pave the rest of it. They just used the minimal part they needed to better improve their previously approved design. So yes, they mentioned they're increasing their paving by about 10%, but that just accounts for really relocating the waste treatment building and kind of taking advantage of a little extra circulation space on the west side. So to their credit, I think what they've proposed here is from my perspective, a win-win solution to something they already had in the works, as they explained, but timing didn't allow them to present it to us previously. So I appreciate the opportunity to share my two cents.
Thank you, Mr. Gales. Other members?
Mr. Chairman, one other comment. I fully agree with Mr. Gales' comments. I do have one thing I would like to say, though, is if there's any further expansion beyond this point, especially heading west, I think there should be some very careful analysis of what effect that's going to have on the west side of this property. Not saying that this will ever happen, but if it does, we're going to be needing quite a major buffer on the west side, just in consideration of what's occurring there, just like we did what was happening on the east side. And I think if it ever comes in front of us again, then we should be very, very careful in our analysis of the expansion beyond that, where it is now. Knowing that there is a buffer there with the creek and whatever, but we have that, I know that, but anything, if that jumps the creek and it moves on further west, I think we should be aware of that and be concerned about it.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to note that I concur with Mr. Hall.
Is there any further discussion? All right, I would entertain a motion at this time.
I would move. I move to approve the PUD amendment subject to conditions in the staff report and subject to the governing body approving the annexation associated with the property at 3636 Southeast 6th Street.
Thank you. Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Armstrong. Anybody need any further discussion before we call for a vote? Hearing none. Miss, would you please call for the vote? Call the vote.
Mr. Armstrong?
Aye.
Ms. Burson?
Aye.
Mr. Gales?
Aye.
Mr. Hall?
Aye.
Ms. Jordan?
Aye.
Mr. Kanar?
Aye.
Ms. Ringler?
Aye.
Mr. Woods?
Aye.
Motion passes 8-0.
Well, thank you. Do we have any further items that need to be discussed, Mr. Finder?
We do not.
All right. Would somebody like to make a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All right. We're adjourned.